All right, good afternoon. I hope you had a decent break, quick, decent break. Couple of quick housekeeping things before I get launched. Anin, correct me if I am wrong or if I missed something. One of the things we're going to request you to do is when you have questions, please line up against the mics. It makes our collective jobs easier. There's, you know, we want to capture these questions also. That's one thing. The second thing is, and this is no pressure on you folks over here, following this panel is, of course, lunch, but there's going to be a group photo.
Yes, so Dick Larson earlier was mentioning a group photo. We will take that down in Lobby 10, so you just go downstairs, you're in Lobby 10, and we're going to take an aerial photo. It's really beautiful light coming in, and so if you want to participate, we'll do that right after the panel on your way to lunch.
Great. That brings us to this wonderful panel. You know, a couple of years ago, MIT launched this task force on the future of higher education with a lot of focus in MIT, which was, in some sense, to look at the increasing centrality of digital learning, the new forces, and try to understand its implications for residential education, education that happens over here, for education, global education, and global defined as not just international education, but about MIT's relationship with sectors that it doesn't engage in a lot, community colleges, the K-12 sector, other countries, other institutions. And of course, and the third pillar was around really looking at what are the implications of all this for the business of education and space utilization, business models, and so on. A recurrent theme in all this, and when you I'd encourage all of you to go to the MIT website, look at this report, and a recurrent theme that came out of these discussions, and especially in the global portion of the task force that I was involved in, Sanjay was leading, was this notion of boundarylessness, and again, boundarylessness writ large. Boundarylessness not just between countries and between, or the blurring of boundaries between the outside and the inside, MIT and the other, between the physical and the virtual, between disciplines. So this notion of boundariness kept surfacing. And this panel, this illustrious panel whom I'm about to introduce, is actually going to, from their experience, which is vast, believe me, and I'll start, going to talk about the transformative implications of boundariness based on their experience, based on the kinds of things that they have led, that they have participated in. And what I have actually asked some of them, but what I hope that they'll address either directly in their comments or through the question and answers is, how do we make ourselves more ready in a systemic way? You know, what are systemic considerations for readiness so that we can actually engage in this positive transformational opportunities that boundarylessness provides? I am going to introduce them possibly in the order. This is not the order that they'll speak in, but in the order, the length of time that I have known them. So Steve Anzalone over here, Dr. Steve Anzalone, is Senior Vice President and Co-Director of EDC. It's their International Development Division, and he's part of their policymaking council. EDC, as you know, is over the years has been very heavily involved in educational development projects. I say in the order that I've known them, I blame Steve Anzalone for me being in this business of educational technology in developing countries. In graduate school, I went as part of a team that Steve led to Lesotho in Southern Africa, and it was the first use of microprocessor-based technologies for elementary education. And we did, we slept speak and spell and speak and math. I taught Logo in Africa, but it was all through. So if there's anything you don't like, blame this guy, right? So that's Steve. Steve has 45 years of experience in assisting educational development in Asia, in Africa, Central America. He's a specialist in the application of education technology, distance education, and multi-channel learning for programs. I know that he's particularly fond of interactive radio, having led championed initiatives on interactive radio in India. He's widely published in scholarly and peer-reviewed journals, He's written several papers with the World Bank. He received his doctorate in education from UMass Amherst with a concentration in non-formal education and adult literacy. That's Steve Anzalone. Phil Schmidt over here, who also I have known for not as long as Steve, but when he first started introducing the notion of peer-to-peer university, he and his colleague, sorry?
Neeru
Paharia, who was the first director of Creative Commons. And we used to meet in open education gatherings. We were both champions of open education in different ways. And Phil is the director of learning innovation at MIT's Media Lab, where he leads the Media Learning Initiative, teaches courses, conducts research on learning communities. He's also a co-founder and board member of Peer-to-Peer University, a nonprofit organization. How many of you have heard of P2P University? Very good. It provides access to online higher education and in public libraries. Philip has served on the founding board of the Open Courseware Consortium and co-authored the Cape Town Open Education Declaration. Those of you who are in the open education realm certainly know about that. He's a Shuttleworth Fellow, Ashoka Fellow, and a Media Lab Director's Fellow. All-round fellow. with equal opportunity, Cristobal Cobo, whom I met in Colombia when my colleague Claudia and I, this is just a couple of months ago, we met. He's director of the Center for Research Celebal Foundation in Uruguay and also an associate researcher at the Oxford Internet Institute, University of Oxford in the UK, where he coordinates research on edtech innovation, open knowledge initiatives, and the future of learning research projects. And last but certainly not the least, and the person who's going to start us off, is Dr. Roxana Morduchowicz, who was the director of the Media Literacy Program. She created a Media Literacy Program for the Ministry of Education in Argentina. She's currently a permanent consultant to the UNESCO on media, information, and digital literacy. She's also the director of the Film Literacy Department at the Argentine Film Academy. She's authored several books and articles in the field, published in Argentina, Spain, and in Latin America. Her most recent one is Adolescence of the 21st Century, based on a research study on young people, media, and technology practices and uses. She's been a speaker at many international forums. She's associated with the UNESCO and the Organization of Ibero-American Studies and she works with governments in order to develop media and digital literacy. We had a very interesting conversation about the need and the interpretation of digital literacy at yesterday evening's reception. She's a professor in communications at the University of Buenos Aires, Argentina, which she claims is the best city in the world, and a frequent visiting professor at the University of Paris, in France. So in that order, to talk about your work, transformative opportunities, and readiness. Reverse order, that's the order.
Good morning. I will not talk about why Buenos Aires is the best city in the world, but keep in mind that. Thank you very much. I would like to start by saying thank you to the organizers for inviting me to this conference, and it's an honor and pleasure to be in this panel. I will talk about what means digital inclusion in the Latin American context, and I will do that by presenting the two main goals and dimensions for a media and digital literacy program in Latin America. The first goal is commitment to democracy. Most of the countries in South America are new democracies. We all suffered strong military dictatorship, so we are strongly convinced that the main goal should be to strengthen the students' public awareness and social participation. The second dimension, the second goal, is also related to this Latin American context where societies are very fragmented and the gaps between rich and poor are still strong. So this is the second goal, the second dimension, inclusion, which means to provide all young people with the necessary competencies for a reflexive and creative use of media and technology. I would like to explain in detail each one of these dimensions, and I will start with commitment to democracy by giving some political context of background information of Argentina. Argentina is a new democracy. It was ruled by a military dictatorship during 8 years. 30,000 young people disappeared. They were kidnapped and killed. Their bodies never appeared, and this is why we call them disappeared people or missing people. There was no freedom of expression, no access to a free press. The media were controlled by the military, and we suffered a strong censorship. We had a terrible war against Britain. It was called the Malvinas War for us, the Falkland War for the British. And during those days, the television, and most of the media, of course, but television broadcast only British casualties. The problem was that after 60 days, the same media announced we lost the war. Thousands of kilometers from Buenos Aires, in London, in a matter of days, the media, the British media, had to convince the British public opinion that it was worth giving their lives for the future of few islands that they had never heard of before. So a strong ideological work was required from the media to persuade the British public opinion of the government's cause. So the Malvinas or Falkland War experience in both a democratic country like Britain at that time and under a dictatorship like the Argentinian one at that time, confirms the need to develop a critical understanding of media and internet. We strongly believe that a media and digital program all over the world, in all new democracies, but also in old democracies, should strengthen the students' public awareness so they learn to avoid any limitations to their participation and any limitations also to their free access to information. In other words, a media and digital program or media and digital education should be all over the world, education for citizenship and education for democracy. The second goal we mentioned is inclusion. And let me explain about this goal by giving two examples of two teenagers living in Buenos Aires, both of them 14 years old, both of them living in the same city. Alice lives in a poor neighborhood. She uses internet mainly to be on Facebook and to watch videos in YouTube. In the same city and the same age, Martha lives in a professional environment. So besides going to Facebook and YouTube, she goes online to look for information about photography, which is her hobby, to watch movies, to listen to music, and to do her homework. It is clear from these two examples, with two teenagers living in the same city, but in different contexts, social contexts, that in uneven contexts, appropriation of technology, media, and culture is also uneven. And this is why we emphasize the importance of inclusion, because the real gap, we think, is the inequality in competencies to make a diversified use of media and internet. We don't speak about access because for the last years, governments all over Latin America distributed tablets and netbooks among public schools. But we think that the real challenge in speaking about inclusion is to provide all students with the necessary competencies to allow them to make a diversified, reflexive, and creative use of media and in technology. So technology is not just seen as an entertainment to go on Facebook or to watch videos in YouTube, but also as an opportunity to critically understand and transform the world. So a media and digital literacy program, which is what I work for UNESCO in Latin America and also in Europe, is concerned with three dimensions: access, which is the departure point, critical understanding of how media and technology construct meanings, and production, how internet can be used to generate new content. Let me say a few words of these three dimensions, which are the basics for a media literacy program. Access is the departure point. And we mean by this, without access, it's impossible to promote any critical thinking. We mean equal and meaningful access to culture, media, and technology for everyone. You may know that in Latin America and many other parts of the world, inequalities are not just related to the newest technology, but also to traditional media and culture. Young people who cannot go to the cinema, to a theater, read a newspaper, have cable TV, etc. So we need to strengthen the students' cultural capital in order to avoid social exclusion. We strongly believe that cultural exclusion also generates social exclusion. So the second dimension we mentioned is critical understanding. And by this, we mean that students should learn to understand how media and internet construct meanings, to contextualize, compare, interpret, and evaluate media and internet content. We know that information for information itself is not enough. So students should learn how to understand how messages are put together, by whom, and in whose interest. Why do we emphasize critical understanding and critical thinking? Again, I would like to give only two examples to justify these important dimensions in a media and digital program. The first example is Diego, a 16-year-old boy student, who explains how he does his homework. He goes to Wikipedia, he goes to Yahoo Answers, and he, of course, he copies, pastes, and prints the right or the answer for the teacher's question. This is far away from the reflexive use we want the schools to promote by using internet. The second example is the result of a research study organized by the Ofcom, the Office of Communication in the United Kingdom, that says that only 1 in 10 students, 12 to 15 years old, recognizes the differences between ads and content online. And 40% of young people say that the information they find in the internet is always true, because if Google included the website, it should be reliable. So this confirms that the knowledge young people have is mainly about technology, is mainly instrumental rather than reflexive. And this is why we need critical thinking and critical understanding. Once again, what really makes a difference is the skills that the students have to understand the social impact, to analyze credibility, to be able to read text in a reflexive way, and of course, to generate new content and participate in the community. So how do we do that? And I will share with you a couple of questions, some questions that we use in teacher training and curriculum materials to promote critical understanding, or what we call digital literacy. So these are only just some of the questions. Why does this link appear in first place? Who produced this text? How does the text transmit its credibility? What is the author's intention? What sources were used to this information? How many points of view are represented? What language is it used? And what audiences are addressed to? So these are some of the questions that we use with teachers in teacher training to promote critical understanding and digital literacy. The third and last dimension, access, critical understanding, and production, which means that students should learn to build their own opinion and be able, of course, to communicate it to others. They should know how to use media and internet in a creative way to express themselves and get a new visibility, so adults will not speak for them, but they will have their own voice, which means that students will become culture producers. To sum up, a media and digital program, literacy program, and inclusion in Latin America, and I would say all over the world, should have 3 dimensions: the right to media, culture, and technology, which means access, a space for critical analysis and understanding, and a site to become culture producers. And all these in order to reinforce the student's civic culture and their commitment to democracy. I would like to finish my presentation. I have a video to show, but this part of the presentation. I would like to finish by quoting a Brazilian, because we don't speak about football, I can quote a Brazilian educator, a very well-known, very well-respected, called Paulo Freire, who said that education will only become the practice of freedom if it teaches students to discover how to participate in the transformation of their world. And this is our main goal in any program, but particularly in a media and digital literacy program. So these are the main principles. And I would like to, because I have 4 and 22 seconds left, I would like to finish my presentation by showing a very short video, 2 minutes long, which reflects all the principles and main ideas that I presented here. And I will do so by using one of the most traditional media that was just mentioned, the radio, in a very small community, 400 people, a very rural and small community, only with 1 public school, a high school, and without any radio station. So we went to the community and we said, we will install you a radio, give the infrastructure for the radio station with only 1 condition. The students in the high school should run the radio, should be in charge of the programming, should be in charge of the radio. And we broadcast the whole process. We register the whole process. We broadcast in one of the TV channels. And what you will see is the last 2 minutes of what happened among the students and in the community once the radio was installed. And I will use the radio because I think that the questions, the main questions and the main principles are always remain the same, are always the same. So while watching the video, and I stopped talking, while watching the video, please keep in mind the principles I mentioned, which are commitment to democracy, inclusion, visibility, participation, and production and critical thinking. So, the video.
Se escucha, donde vas se escucha la radio y eso está buenísimo.
Para toda la gente en las panelías, sé que estamos en eso.
Y a nosotros nos cambió la vida el tema de una radio. Bueno, tenemos familia en Roca, venimos de allá, de Río Negro, y bueno, la familia se enteró que había una radio, así que nos llaman, mandan saludos.
Somos 400 y algo de vecinos. Yo creo que 390 escuchan la radio.
Para la gente de la municipalidad de Puerto Pirámide, que está trabajando, bomberos, policía. Para las cocinas que se están escuchando, de todos los que están por acá.
Cambió mucho la forma de transmitir un mensaje, ¿no?
La Comisión Directiva del Club Centro Deportivo y Cultural de Puerto Pirámides
informa a sus socios que a partir de esta semana ya
comienza yoga.
Pero ponele, desde que él dijo que arranca yoga, todo el mundo está con que hay yoga. O sea, se reescucha. Sí, hoy.
Hay que saludar al tango. Hoy es el cumpleaños del tango.
Claro, claro. ¡Feliz cumpleaños, tango! ¡Feliz cumpleaños de parte de la radio, de parte de todos los chicos!
Bueno, el 10 fue mi cumpleaños y se enteró todo el pueblo. Me mandaron un saludo por la radio en el pueblo y que escuche mandarle saludo a Sandra por su cumpleaños es algo como que... Mira vos, es como, viste que el cumpleaños es algo muy, muy de uno. Yo salí el otro día y recibí 500 besos, siendo que años anteriores me daban un beso los de mi familia porque sabían que era mi cumpleaños.
Como que se tira una información y se... Está bueno.
Mi vida cambió bastante, diría yo. He dedicado mucho más tiempo a la radio a lo que hacía antes. Que, bueno, no hacía nada.
Y sirvió también para esto, ¿no? Para acercar a los chicos de que estaban alejados de la escuela.
La playa tiene una torre. La torre tiene un balcón. El balcón tiene una dama. La dama, una blanca flor.
Ya, si quieres salimos de ahí.
En realidad le mando un saludo a toda mi familia, incluso la de Buenos Aires, que deben estar escuchando, o tal vez no.
Ojalá dentro de poco estemos ya a Buenos Aires, ¿no?
Te das cuenta cuando están felices de que pase algo en el pueblo.
Como la gente escucha, es como que hay más comunicación entre todo el pueblo.
¿Y qué fueron a hacer a la radio?
A decir consejitos.
¿Consejitos para cuidar qué?
El planeta.
El planeta.
Sí, de planes.
De planet, en inglés lo dijo Amadeo, muy bien.
Todo el mundo quiere, se ve reflejado. Es una cosa que fue lo más. O sea, lo que estábamos esperando muchísima gente acá.
Yo creo que modificó la vida de todos. La radio cambió la rutina, la vida de todos. Ahora tenemos algo más que hacer. Y eso está bueno.
Thank you very much.
Can you hear me? Apparently, yes. All right, so is it working? Yeah. First of all, thank you very much for having me here. Thank you to MIT and BJ, Claudia, for the invitation. It's such a pleasure to be here. I'll talk to you about Uruguay. How many of you have been in Uruguay? Can I ask? Few. How many of you could confidently pin in the map where Uruguay is? Okay, not bad. I may understand that it's a small country, only 3.5 million inhabitants. 10 years ago, Uruguay, inspiring Nicolas Negroponte, in this campus, they decided to go for the One Laptop Per Child initiative, providing computers to every single kid and connectivity to all the schools. And we have learned many things out of that. Not only changing the technological infrastructure, you will be changing the mindset of people. Technology is not enough to move into openness and being open to other ways of learning, other ways of teaching. But the other thing, which is really important that we learn after these 10 years, is when you turn a privilege into a right. Remember, 10 years ago, having a laptop or a tablet was really a privilege. When you change a privilege into a right, there's no way back. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to talk about, not a lot about technology, but I'm going to refer much more on what has been going on in terms of these other conditions that may enable to facilitate learning in different ways. This is a work that Claudia Broveto, Fiorella Gago wrote with me, or I wrote with them, I don't know. I have to mention their names, otherwise they will kill me. And what I'm going to refer now is a global network in which UY is part of. It's a really interesting and challenging initiative because it's a kind of action research, it's a living lab in a really large extent, and also I will identify some of the challenges behind. Let me start mentioning that this is framed in a partnership called New Pedagogies for Deep Learning. How does it work? It's a really broad network of countries which have been decided to work together, connecting schools, 100 schools in each one of those countries, creating a cluster of innovation. How does it work? Different schools face different problems, and when they explore possible solutions, they share those solutions with other schools in the same country, and afterwards, with other countries. Okay, sounds interesting, but a little bit messy. There are a few interesting things of this approach. First of all, this really broad-scale networks of schools with widely diverse cultural backgrounds. The second thing is learning by creating, inspiring John Dewey and others, this idea that you can learn better when you practice. And the third thing, how to move forward a new accountability of the learning outcomes that can go beyond the traditional ways of assessing. And believe me, this is really, really difficult. So let me tell you a little bit about this. What is the flavor behind this approach? Co-creation. So Paulo Freire was mentioned a minute ago. Rather than thinking in the learners as this empty container that need to be filled, thinking in this active learning, which the learners play a much more protagonist role. And learners, not only the students, but the community as a whole. Learning in terms of focusing on translating and negotiating knowledge from different disciplines and different backgrounds. The second component is exploration. Exploration means that it's okay to fail because it's a key part of the process. And when you move into that, you really change the landscape. Similarly, the idea of experimentation. When you think in new ways of learning as a better version, you really change the mindset of teachers in terms of you are not criticizing their work. They don't need to defend their work, but they are embracing in this exploration. And finally, evaluation. In a word, it's not only to value what you measure, but also is to measure what you value, although it can be difficult to measure. And deep learning is grounded in some of these skills that I'm sure you're really familiar with. We have seen that tag and labeling with different umbrellas, 21st century skills, soft skills, people skills, even hard to measure skills have been called somewhere. We call it 6 C's. But the soul of this initiative is to enable collaborative problem-solving initiatives, addressing challenges which are relevant for the students and encouraging them to use knowledge from different disciplines, from different contexts, to explore possible solutions and then share those solutions with others. So there are a number of ways how to do that. The first one is strongly multidisciplinary projects. So the boundaries between disciplines here are not applicable and not relevant because the idea is to bridge knowledges from different backgrounds. The second thing is this idea of measuring in a different way. It doesn't make a lot of sense to innovate in the technology and innovate in the pedagogies if you don't innovate in the way that you measure. So progressions and other ways of assessing and identifying the skills are really, really important. And also, when we say the students are co-creators, they also can be co-creators of the evaluations as well, not only a passive subject that is evaluated. And that is really a challenging goal because that really means to change the language of the school. Not only addressing summative assessment, but formative assessment and finding bridges between, which is something that may sound similar, easy, but it's not all that similar. And the other topic is networks of schools. It might sound obvious, but it's not that obvious. Sometimes the school, they don't have enough exchanges between themselves. And when you open these environments of exploration, you create really interesting bonds behind. Now, let me tell you a little bit about Uruguay. This is an initiative that has been promoted by the National Administration of Public Education and Plan Saival. Plan Saival is this one laptop per child initiative that I mentioned earlier at the beginning. So in a way, this is a top-down initiative. Good. There are a few interesting things about Uruguay. It's a strongly egalitarian country, a strong middle class with a stable democracy and advanced legislation. I don't know if you're familiar with, but marijuana is about to be legal there, so you're very welcome to come. And very low levels of corruption, but not everything is a rose garden. We have a number of problems in education. Only 70% of the children who start middle school are able to complete the cycle. And only 40% of the students who start in the high school are able to graduate. And finally, in the first year, middle schools were up to 30% of children who repeat. So we are facing really strong problems. The second one is this a highly hierarchical structure, strongly centralized and with little opportunities for horizontal innovation. And the third aspect that can be contradictory with what I mentioned earlier is socially stratified. So students from low or middle-low incomes, they perform lower than the rest. So that is really a problem because it's increasing the inequality of the social gap. Now, how are we working on it? In the ground, in the context of these new pedagogies for deep learning, promoted by this initiative, Red Global, we are doing a lot of work in capacity building, again, changing the language of the school, changing the what is understood as knowledge and what is the role of the educator, and with a strong emphasis as well in the idea of exploring new ways of measuring the learning outcomes. And the idea is some of these learning outcomes, but particularly some of these learning currencies, knowledge currencies which are behind, are exchanged with other countries, and there's a really interesting innovation ecosystem. So what are the interesting things of this country, of this experience in particular, this leading action research? One is the scale. Usually we see a lot of innovations in different countries, but in many cases those innovations are tested in pilot contexts, strongly controlled, well off, or really, really interested in make this pilot happen. And the idea here is to move in a larger scale. So it's, the first year was 100, the second year they replicate to other 100 schools, and now the idea is to increase up to 10, 15 times that in the whole educational system. The second thing is this idea of multiple innovation fluxes. So it's a top-down, because it's the government promoting this initiative, but it's a bottom-up as well, because learners, they do have a voice here, and they can claim and complain and suggest all the things that have been addressed. And also, it's an open innovation initiative, because the whole spirit of that is to share the learning outcomes with other schools elsewhere in the world. Now, one of the interesting things is we, in this context, understand teachers as learners. So there is a really interesting association between education and learners in which they're okay to explore ideas together. So within the school and with other schools, as I said. And the other aspect that can sound a little bit contradictory with what I mentioned at the beginning is technology is not the goal. So we have a invisible understanding of technology or a tacit understanding of technology, which means technology can be used, is very welcome to be used, but it's defined by the students and not by the educator. If the kids want to go with robotic, programming, stop motion, 3D printers, they're okay to do that and we facilitate that. But technologies are driven by the learners. And we don't provide any kind of training on how to use technology because we think we can contribute stronger in other things. Other aspects that is relevant are the deep challenges. So The challenges are we raise some of the concerns that kids have, I will mention some as examples, and we give a number of weeks to explore possible solutions and then share those solutions with the schools in other parts of the world, such as how to develop carbon footprint-friendly devices, how to eat better, how to talk beyond the boundaries of languages, and how to explore sustainable energy in a different way. You wouldn't expect that kids would be worried about these sort of things, but in this case, has been a really, really encouraging example. I'll show you a little bit of that.
Los kits, pero no podíamos tocarlos ni nada, entonces le pedimos a la maestra para poder usarlos. Y ahí empezó todo, mirando biolecciones y construyendo cosas.
Las biolecciones es cuando, o sea, aprendimos por medio de videos del canal de YouTube de Silvani.
Bueno, fue increíble. Ahí me sentí, dije, la tecnología acelera 100%, porque los chiquines se encontraron con una biolección y clasificaron piezas del kit, lo armaron, lo programaron en 2 jornadas de 2 horas.
Nuestro próximo desafío es juntar la tecnología verde con los kits de robótica y poder hacer un robot que solucione un problema de la humanidad.
En mi clase hicimos con la maestra el tema de guerras mundiales y a mí se me ocurrió hacer un robot que detecte las minas.
Me parece importantísimo que ellos hayan pensado en una solución para nuestro planeta.
Este robot fue creado para la huerta. Este tiene un sensor de movimiento, cuando pasa algo por delante empieza a vibrar. Y entonces eso lo pondríamos ahí con una alarma. Y si pasa un pájaro que quiere comer las plantas, sonaría la alarma.
De que los mismos niños pueden sortear dificultades con mayor facilidad dentro de lo que es el manejo de la tecnología a lo que de repente puedo hacerlo yo.
Este proyecto yo hice. Con la maestra le pusimos Terminator, con una pila de 9 voltios, con un cepillo, con 2 vibradores Justin y con cables.
Vi que había ese intercambio con la casa, porque los chiquitos precisaban la ayuda de los papás, entonces ya estaban buscando qué iban a usar, qué no iban a usar.
Usamos un problema que había como nuestro barrio, claro, que se juntan en vez de la humanidad, la achicamos un poco a nuestro barrio, a nuestro contenido, a nuestro
barrio Camalín. Y me asombré de que estaban apuntando a un problema real, que tenían conciencia ciudadana de lo que estaba pasando en este barrio.
En 2012, en la playa Malvin acá, murieron 5 personas porque cayó un rayo, entre ellas un niño. Entonces lo que queremos evitar es que en el mundo y en Uruguay, se termine este fenómeno, que no haya más, no haya más muertes en las playas debido a rayos. Trata de que cuando va a caer un rayo, te avise.
In order to be on time, just let me wrap up. So there are some challenges, definitely a number of challenges behind this initiative. The first one is this really demand and change of the mindset. And that is not always that easy. It's not as speedy as installing technology. And it's interesting because sometimes this tension with the changing of mindset is coming from educators or principals, but sometimes it's coming from parents. So it's a whole different language, and it takes some time. The second thing is, the idea is to define not a single unified metric how to trace and how to identify the progression of those outcomes, but to explore a tool set, an ecology of possibilities. The third challenge is participation. In some of the training, sometimes we have only one set of the participants, and this social innovation changes only happen if you have the people on your side. So this is something that we are working really hard on. New pedagogies for deep learning aims at the end of the day to put the learnings at the center, but exploring a curriculum that go way beyond the classroom. And the technology, although the technology luckily is already there, because the kids already have it, the idea is to use it in the most flexible and widely diverse possible ways that they can. And this is definitely a benefit. So at the end of the day, rather than improving the scores, which is what you usually see in many of the education programs, the idea is to increase the relevance of the learning process wherever it takes place. And they now in Uruguay, they are discussing if they will scale up this program into a larger scale or not. And this is a matter to be seen, but I'll be happy to be in the next link to tell you about that. So before finishing, just to say that we have learned that learning is a social practice, and this is, I guess, where is the main innovation. Thank you.
Moving right along, Steve. Good morning. It's great being here with you. I'd like to begin by asking a little bit of indulgence on your part. And this is the first time since I can't even remember, I haven't been speaking about educational technology. I'm going to speak today about youth and boundaries. Perhaps there is a connection in there after all. I'm also going to try to pack a lot into 15 minutes. If we hit moments of incoherence, we can maybe try to sort that out when the presentation is done. Okay, I'd like you to consider this. We have, today there are 1.8 billion young people. Young people are defined, depending on organizations and that, most commonly, I would say, 15 to 24, but sometimes 14 to 35. But they vary. 120 million young people are going to reach working age each year. In developing countries, which is what I'm going to focus on today, 60% are not in regular employment or in school. Not in regular employment doesn't mean they're not working. Let me go back. If I have one more. And finally, many people still see youth as a problem for society rather than as an asset. While we see them as assets, that doesn't mean they don't face many obstacles. I have, as Vijay had mentioned, worked with an international NGO. It's called the Education Development Center. We were actually founded on this campus in 1958, kind of spun off. We're headquartered over in Waltham, and we have offices in Washington and New York. We do a variety of things, but one of the things we're most proud of is the work we do with youth in developing countries. And we have programs now have had programs in about 30 different places. They've been funded by bilateral agencies, international groups, and foundations, and some by corporations themselves. We kind of pride ourselves in working in places where that might be described as having terrain is a little bit difficult, jobs are scarce, and the lives of young people are really kind of complicated by some very tough issues. Here is one of our projects that just closed in Garissa, Kenya, up on the northeast part near the Somalia border. Not an easy place, 90% unemployment. Al-Shabaab comes over the border, and all sorts of conflict that these young people have to deal with. Place near, very dear to my heart, Mindanao in the Philippines. Again, very difficult conditions, conflict every day. Often the conflict coming from someone who is a terrorist in the morning, changes hat in the afternoon, just an ordinary for-profit kidnapper. And Honduras, again, a lot of the programs, not just about finding work and identity and all of that, but so much of the lives of youth beset by the violence associated with gangs. So anyway, the programs that we do tend to vary from place to place. We try to put them together with kind of according to the local circumstances, and often those circumstances increasingly are defined and led by the young people themselves. One of the things that does tend to emerge as kind of a common core, if we will, in our program, is the interest in what is called soft skills. We have focused on this because this is both young people are interested in this side, and in conversations with employers and communities, the thing that emerges is most often is that the students just simply lack some of the necessary preparation to be able to find a job or to start a little business on their own. We have a program that it's called Work Readiness, and again, it's to prepare young people either to find a job, be able to advance in the job that they have, or to perhaps to start one of their own. Ours isn't the only work readiness curriculum. There are several out there, and I invite you, if you're interested in this, you can explore them on the web. Ours consists of about 8 modules, and we do about 44 to 100 hours of programming. You might guess it contains a variety of soft skills, work habits, leadership, safety and work at school, interpersonal communications, personal development, things like that. And as we got to this, though, it seemed kind of a natural progression, but it wasn't. We encountered boundaries in the trajectory of how it was we were going to connect with young people and what it is we would kind of do together. We were educators. We started out with kind of the notions of education and what happens in schools, and you get to youth, well, maybe we failed somewhere along the line because they weren't getting jobs. No, that boundary took us only so far. We had to actually get into what really were the requirements in the workplace, in the community, in the things that were going on, very unrelated to the world of the schools that we knew so well. Another boundary, boom. All of a sudden, there are sort of business concerns and all of these sorts of things, and things having to do with employment, dealing with business people. Again, many of us as educators hadn't been prepared for this, but we had to go over that boundary. Then we had the boundary of, not just about jobs. What do you do in places where there aren't any jobs? The 90% unemployed. What do you do? Well, then it was about finding some kind of a livelihood that wouldn't be a job, that would have to be able to help someone really along the way to be able to meet the really kind of the minimum basic things of life. As educators, as an educator, training, well, that's a little different. We started out there and figured, we'll get it. But pretty soon in the programs, we found it wasn't really a lot about training or skills transfer. It was really a lot about psychosocial support, health, a whole lot of other issues. So those are the kind, if any of you are interested in the world of youth and that, these are some of the boundaries that I think that you'll face and that you'll probably have come to cross. Now we get interesting. That was now. This is what we got, but we think we're going to have to look down the road a little bit. And in that, I'm introduced here by Vijay here. When we were in graduate school, we were in a program it was called a Future Studies Program. So we were little futurists in that. And as we looked ahead, one of the things we learned is that a futurist is not really necessarily one who makes really accurate predictions. A futurist, as we defined it, was someone that made future possibilities more real for others. And I hope we can engage in a little of that today. In so doing, I want to consider one of the most influential pieces of futurism that the world has ever seen. Some of you may have seen it. It's called The Jetsons. It was a TV show, and As those of you who haven't seen it, maybe you've heard about it, because it comes up a lot. World, a lot of robots and interesting gadgets and devices and that. But the interesting thing about it is in the center there, George Jetson, the daddy, goes to work every day. Oh, he goes to work every day with that. Some of the newer scenarios that people are putting out as we look toward the year 2030 don't see George Jetson necessarily going to work every day. You can see there's a very interesting scenario that's starting to gain some traction. It comes, and you will see recently it came in the Atlantic, and that it would see that about half of the jobs in the U.S. are subject to disappearing by 2030. This is starting to get some traction in terms of other countries and other situations as well. Rightly or wrongly, it's starting to get some traction. I was in Thailand, and I saw this being mentioned as a possibility for the future there, a university beginning to plan around that. The important thing for us is not, again, whether it's right or wrong. Of course, it's going to vary from place to place, but I think something like that is going to be happening around us, and we got to begin thinking about what those implications would be for not just as a society, but for kind of programs that we offer. It's not so far-fetched. Look at Greece and Spain today. 50% are unemployed already. They've really got a head start. So anyway, we wanted to look quickly at what would a program look like for young people based on that kind of world where possibly half of the people aren't going to have a regular job. I'm going to leave most of that to you to think about that. But there are certain things that I think we're going to have to. I think we would want to consider. Programs that built a sense of purpose and identity and dignity that was unattached to work. It's going to be easier in some countries than it would in the United States, for example. How do we fill the day with satisfaction rather than disaffection? How do we build? It's going to take massive, I think, connectivity that will go way across boundaries to diasporas, to youth groups all over the world. Great possibilities there. We're going to have to deal with the diverse sources of income, how young people will be able to connect to starting their own business, to spot employment. U.S. may, other countries may have a kind of a universal basic income that may be supplemented by episodic, what have you. There's going to be an important area that I think we have to address. And, of course, there will be mediated experiences we have yet to imagine. If we just think back 14 years ago, there were things that we couldn't, that we hadn't really even considered or dreamt of. So anyway, I would like to close by just showing you what I'll call an opportunity grid. For those of you who may be interested in connecting to this world, and there's a lot of interest now on the part of organizations, donors, funders, and that, to be able to support a little more than there has been past programs for youth that really aren't necessarily part of the educational system. And maybe I'm dating myself, but I'll plot this on a two-dimensional grid. Mine can go only so far. But down on the vertical grid, you'll see kind of what would be the kind of programs that would be really much is work readiness now. What do we do actually as we have then to prepare someone for the world of work? And on the other grid would be, what do we do to prepare? And I hate to say we prepare, to prepare. Youth are going to mostly lead this themselves, and we're going to provide resources and connections as best we can. On the immediate side, you'll see toward the apex there, programs that won't look, they'll be much the same. And in many countries, they'll continue to be much the same. But the further out you get, where the work aspect is going to be somewhat more remote to the young people. That's where I think we're going to have to start, where I think we're going to require a greater amount of imagination. So anyway, we just kind of like to close by saying that I hope some of you interested in applications, those other experiences, partnerships, whatever, with young people overseas, I hope that you will give some a thought to this as you try to make your way. Unfortunately, there aren't a lot of boundaries to help you navigate. Some of you may find that troubling, but you know, I think it's very exciting. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. As Phil gets ready, I just want to tell you folks to start collecting your questions so that this is not to rush anyone, so that you're lined up. This is a good time to think about what you might be bringing forth to the discussion.
Thank you.
Philip, your answer?
Great, thank you. So I work up the road here at the MIT Media Lab. Some of you may have been there last night for the reception and for a drink.
Steve.
And when I saw the picture of the Jetsons, Steve. I didn't grow up in the US, so I didn't really have the cultural reference, but the picture reminded me a little bit of what my workplace looks like. There are a lot of people building robots and thinking about the future of the world and building technology. But one of the really interesting things about the Media Lab that we don't often talk about first when we think about the Media Lab is its culture of learning. The Media Lab is 30 years old. It has 26 research groups. There's a lot of intergroup collaboration. There's a lot of hands-on research. There's a lot of technology innovation. But from the very beginning, there have been people at the Media Lab who really deeply cared about how we learn inside a university, but also how we learn outside of universities. And so I would say that the Media Lab doesn't just talk about creative learning, but it really has a culture of creative learning. And I'll skip through this quickly and get to kind of the examples. And my colleague Mitch Resnick is speaking at this conference, I think tomorrow. And he really is one of the originators of the thinking around creative learning. He's been there running a research group called Lifelong Kindergarten. And in a way, kindergarten, actually, this Media Lab is like the kindergarten meets the Jetsons, I think is kind of the best description. So I'll just say every framework has to have a bunch of words with the same first letter. Ours is called creative learning, and we have the letter P. We sometimes talk about the four P's of creative learning, and we try to implement those in the way that people learn at the Media Lab. So our students work on projects. They collaborate with peers. There's very little hierarchy. Seemingly, when you kind of walk in, you're never quite sure, is someone a student or a faculty or a researcher? Our students work on things that they're passionate about, so really connecting to the things that that they care about deeply. And we do it in a way that allows experimentation and failure. And so we use the term play and playfulness for that. Just as background, I try to kind of stick with the theme, education without boundaries, and talk about two examples. And it's actually really close to my heart. Maybe even my work before the Media Lab connects to this more strongly. And Vijay didn't say this, but he's partly responsible for me going in this direction, because I think we met 2008 or 2007 at a conference, and there was a small group of people that was talking about this idea that we called peer-to-peer university. And the idea was that there was going to be all this content online, and if you brought together a bunch of people around it, you could learn anything you wanted in the future, and you could connect with them online. And it was kind of 2008 is a long time. This seems perfectly normal now. 2008, it was kind of a crazy idea. And so we went to an education conference, and we said, you know, we're going to run a workshop to talk about this idea of peer-to-peer university, and there were a bunch of people, and we said, well, here's what we have in mind, and we really want to kind of talk to you about, is this a good idea, or is it, you know, crazy, you're all experts? And there was a lot of hesitation, and people, what about accreditation? But there was one guy in the back who was, like, waving his arm like crazy, and he was like, this is a great idea! And then I said, well, sorry, can you introduce yourself? I'm Vijay Kumar from MIT. So I learned a couple of things. One is Vijay is an enthusiastic innovator for kind of new things, but also that if you say I'm from MIT, somehow people listen a lot more than if you say you're from University of the Western Cape, which is where I was working at the time. So it really helped us kind of get started, and so we went ahead. And in a way, this first project, which is now affiliated with the Media Lab, came out of that. So we founded Peer-to-Peer University, and in a way, kind of the world changed around us. And people who were concerned about access to education and boundaries and barriers were very excited when the MOOCs appeared. There were these online courses offered by the best universities of the world. They were free. Anyone could take them. And so the education problem was seemingly solved. It turns out that it didn't quite work that way. And there were a few things that, while the MOOCs really opened up a new conversation, a few things didn't work as well as maybe we were hoping in the initially. So one is that free of cost doesn't mean that people really have access. Access means digital literacy, which Roxana talked about. Access means lack of connectivity. Access means even just having the time to take these courses when you're having a busy day. So thinking about access more broadly. And secondly, taking an online course often doesn't help you develop the important life success skills that you would develop if you go to a university like MIT or many other universities. You know, engaging with other people, collaborating, communicating, all the things that make you kind of a nice person afterwards to work with, and the things that really you're doing every day, those skills are often not explicitly supported in the online courses. And then the other one is social support is missing. We know from the Harvard assessment study that even at the best universities in the world, the students really learn after the lecture when they sit together with other students and they ask questions and they teach each other. And so bringing the social support in the online space seemed important. And so we were Peer-to-Peer University, we were around for a few years, we still are, but we were focused on online initially. And so we reached a lot of people that were highly sophisticated learners and users, many of them in developed countries. But we had set out with this ambition that the web and technology could help broaden access. And so we were somewhat frustrated that somehow our model wasn't really reaching people that we were hoping would participate. And so we kind of went through this identity crisis for a little while, and we decided that maybe the solution wasn't a new technology, but it could be a very old idea. And the idea is that people have always met at the public library to learn things together. And so we kind of came back to that idea and we said, okay, well, if you have all these online courses now, how could we connect that to the public library and help people come together at the library and take these courses? And that's what we've been doing for the past year and a half. So we bring together real people in real places. The people who come to these, we call them learning circles. People who sign up for these learning circles often have never taken an online course before. Over 60% have never taken an online course. Many of them are not sophisticated computer users. There were some homeless people who sign up. So it's a totally different demographic to participate in online learning. These learning circles are very lightly facilitated. So there's no expert. We don't have teachers on staff. There's no one in the room who teaches the rest of the group. The group comes together. They pick an online course that they want to take from a list of curated courses. And then they work through kind of a weekly recipe together. But it's really about them figuring out how to support each other rather than waiting for someone else to teach them. And then the amazing thing has been that kind of people who come through this, right now they get a certificate that really isn't accredited in any way, but it's deeply meaningful for the participants. And I think this is my hypothesis, and we haven't tested this, but I think it's much more about confidence than it is about maybe certified skills. Right? Like people set out to learn something, they take an online course, they stick with it. We have about 50% completion rate. And when they get to the end of it, they've learned that they can do this, and we're hoping that they actually transition into formal education afterwards. So we started in Chicago Public Library. They've been our R&D partner from the beginning. We're going to be in 5 US library systems by the end of this year and have 2 international pilots in Kenya and in Paris. But there's also an open source toolkit. So if anyone wants to start learning circles or do anything related, you're very welcome to take the materials where we'll give you free advice or input. And we hope that there'll be kind of a community of people doing similar things. The second example I want to talk about a little bit is a Media Lab project that we started about a year and a half ago, which is really about the idea of credentials. Very different. So if you were, I have to check the date here. Where is it? If you were 24 years old and from Hungary, and you were trying to become a carpenter, a few hundred years ago, 1829, there it is. 1829, then you would have one of these books, and you would travel around Europe, and you would do internships with master carpenters, and then they would write a little review for you, and they'd put a stamp in there, and then you kind of build up your reputation or your kind of series of learning accomplishments in your book, and then you would take that book and you'd move along and you'd go to the next place. And this actually is still practiced today in Europe. But this book idea kind of seemed like a nice way to think about accreditation in the modern world, where in some ways we could be going through similar experiences. We start in one place, we work with a group of people, we get some feedback from them, maybe they'll give us a stamp of approval, then we'll go to the next place, we'll take an online course here, we'll study a year at a university, we'll go into the job. And so why doesn't our accreditation system support more models like this? And so at the Media Lab, if this... That's not the sound I want to hear. It's just louder. So I need someone to fix this. My Apple ID is now being used for iMessage on a new Mac. That is not. Okay, here we go. Yes. So at the Media Lab, we went ahead and we're like, okay, well, what could credentials look like in the digital world that still have this idea that comes from the book? And so we made some. We made new types of credentials for our. We started with the director's fellows, and we made really nice coins also, because having a physical representation seemed like a good idea. There's also, I don't have time, but there's a whole world around challenge coins, which is absolutely fascinating. And so we made these coins, we gave them to the director's fellows, and when they see each other, they can put the coin on the table and kind of say, hey, I'm a director's fellow, and the other person puts their coin, and if you forgot to bring your coin, then you have to buy a round of drinks for everyone. But because we're the Media Lab, we didn't just make the physical ones, we also made digital ones, and a digital one really. So this is the only somewhat complicated slide. The idea is really that we put all the information that you would want in your credential into a digital file. We then sign it cryptographically, and we place a summary of this file onto the Bitcoin blockchain. It has nothing to do with money. We're just using the Bitcoin infrastructure to store these pieces of information. And then we give the digital file of the certificate to the student or the recipient. And because we, as the Media Lab, signed the certificate, and it's also been assigned to a public key of the recipient, you could now go anywhere in the world and tell people that you have a director's fellow's degree or a certificate, and they can verify that you are the person who has it, that the certificate hasn't been tampered with, and that MIT, or the Media Lab in this case, issued it without ever having to go back to the Media Lab. And so that's very important, that this is completely decentralized. We're using the Mozilla Open Badges specification, so this is backwards compatible, and doing it on the Bitcoin blockchain. So what does this give us? Well, one of the things that it gives us is that your digital certificate can have this little button that says verify, And if you click on this, it goes through this complicated process of fetching digital data and hashing it and comparing the hashes. And you don't actually have to do that yourself. You could rely on a verifier. But you don't have to rely on one particular verifier. Because all of this code is open source, you can take the code, you can run it yourself if you want to, you can trust someone else to run it for you, you can trust three different organizations to run it for you, and then you can verify these certificates. So coming back to that original idea, you know, if we start with our, so this actually, we started issuing certificates for alumni as well to just kind of see what that would look like. So our alumni, our directors, fellows, you know, you could start collecting. We partnered with MITx for the entrepreneurship MOOC, so people who came to their workshop in Korea got a digital certificate. We partnered with a group in Mexico City where people who came to their workshops got a digital certificate. And so you could kind of, you know, on and on and on, you could start compiling really the history of your academic achievements in the form of these digital certificates and then share them with other people to verify. So these are just two Media Lab projects, and I want to end on just kind of teeing up a new conversation that I know tomorrow there's a panel that will talk about this a lot more. But when I thought about education without boundaries, then learners without borders is kind of, there's both a positive side to that, but there's also a really serious side to that, and that's the refugee crisis. Right, there are estimate 4 million Syrian refugees displaced from Syria, many more internally displaced. There are roughly 60 million people who are migrants at the moment, and that number is expected to grow to 600 million people by the end of the century, mainly caused by the effects of climate change and then the resulting economic and political instability. But the point I'm making is that there is going to be a much larger group of people that need access to higher education that are not, that will not have access to the same kinds of institutions that we are talking about, mostly talking about today. And so thinking about kind of what does higher education look like in the future is one of the things that the Media Lab is very interested in, and we're going to be hosting a few workshops in Dubai, in New York, in Amman, and working with some of the people actually who are in this room on trying to think about some ways that technology could help here. That's it. Thank you very much.
So you heard our panelists present various perspectives on boundarylessness. In fact, I was quite taken by the diverse interpretations, the boundaryless interpretations of boundarylessness, you know, and which is really very good. Questions for the panelists, and in terms of any of the initiatives that they've talked about or particular considerations that they have popped up. And again, I'm going to ask you folks to come and use the mics.
Hello, my name is Tanya Waldberger, and I do media production at Brown University, and I had a question for Dr. Schmidt. You mentioned on one of your slides how, you know, one of the things that MOOCs doesn't do very well is this social interaction. And so my question is, when you're thinking about smaller scale online courses where there is much more teacher-student engagement and participation and feedback, how do you take a model like that? Do you see a model like that being successful, and how could you scale something like that?
Well, so I founded an organization called Peer-to-Peer University, so I have a bias against relying on the experts too much. I think small groups of people that are interested in the same thing can really make great progress even without having a more traditional expert in the room. On the other hand, of course, if you can sit in a small seminar style, you know, surrounded by other people who are passionate about the topic you're passionate about, and then you have access to someone who has a lot more experience who can guide the conversation, I think mentors are extremely important. I don't see the traditional model scaling well, though. So I think we need to think about both broadening who we consider experts and mentors, right? So bringing people from the private sector into these conversations, retired academics. You know, there are lots of groups of people that have extreme significant expertise that are not really part of the day-to-day teaching and learning in higher education. So I think, for me, that's probably the most interesting direction to kind of think about alumni, you know, other experts that could then, and that would probably be, well, could be remote or face-to-face. So you could imagine plugging into one of these learning circles at the library, someone who is a retired professor. One of the things that's interesting is there's something about the dynamics in the group that changes when you have an expert. And so one of the other library systems in the US did a similar project that didn't work as well. And they hired experts to teach locally. And then the online course was kind of supplementary. And I think there's kind of this sense of ownership and participation that if you're responsible, you know, you're much more engaged. And having the expert there, I think, can actually be just in a way limiting that. But really good question.
In fact, just an annotation over there, because one of the things that we talk about, Philip talked about open and networks, and our tendency is to immediately think about open and networks as providing extensive access to content. But perhaps the biggest thing they're doing is providing extensive access to communities. And what we have seen, and even in the MOOCs that have been launched by MIT, you know, when initially you start off with the assumption that there are three instructors and 300,000 people, like a one-to-many experience is rapidly transformed into a many-to-many experience. And so the agency of the community, both as a provider in terms of providing scaffolding to the learning experience, you know, is greatly enhanced. And your open badges, the innovative approach, you know, actually leverages that aspect of communities. Archana?
Hello, I'm Archana Mahindere from Tata Institute of Social Sciences, India. I have a question to Dr. Cobo. I wanted to actually ask about the school networks that you mentioned. So can you please elaborate on the school networks?
Sure. So
The one that I mentioned is called New Pedagogies for Deep Learning. So the idea was kind of creating a club of countries who wanted to be part of this initiative. But this is not the only one that we are being part of. One of the initiatives that we are being part of is called Design for Change. So the idea is coming from India. It's an initiative really, really interesting in which using somehow an adapted version of the, design thinking, the idea is similarly to invite the kids to identify problems in education. And after they identify those problems, they start designing projects. And if they want, they can involve teachers. So I guess our goal is to enable as many communities and networks as possible in order to explore different ways of learning and exchange. But I'm happy to provide you more details about the first one if you want.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have two questions. My name is Vincent Zimmer from Kiron. First goes to Uruguay. I actually know about your program because part of it is Bettermarks, startup based in Berlin that provides math education for classes 5 to 12. And I just want to like to share the experience that they're serving very well in Uruguay, and now serving as a, so Uruguay is now serving actually as a role model for the school system we have in Germany, which I found very, very interesting. But the question related to that is, the challenge is that the researchers are aware of that and the people who are doing this are aware of that, but I think there's a lack of information transport to the ministry officials who actually make the decisions. So I'd like to know how we can, maybe in your experience, better transport the success stories and put them faster into place. My second question goes to Philipp. Probably, you know, we know each other, so you know we're using a lot of the things you're developing here at MIT. And one of the two challenges we're experiencing is, first of all, access, but not in terms of community, but in terms of hardware, like internet connectivity and like actually real hardware, like laptop and stuff. Because we're working in countries that are often not democratic, often not open, often controlling the internet. Just first, how can we overcome that? And maybe the bigger challenge here is that we have a differentiation between resources. So we have, especially in the US, the content producers, we have the people who actually need it in the developing countries, and we have a lot of NGOs and foundations in between, but I'm missing a bit the one actor that feels responsibility of connecting all these dots. Because you pointed out how community on the ground can help to use the content that is produced already in a very good way. But in our experience, there needs to be someone who's creating these communities who help them start. And I wonder who could that be in your experience, in your opinion? Thank you.
Well, so The access question is interesting because I hadn't anticipated it as much as it's, like, as I've been learning about the space, because there's this assumption that now everyone has a smartphone and everyone has access to mobile data, and so, you know, access is going to be not a problem. And the reality is that for many people, access still is a problem. So I think some solutions are technical, you know, providing local hotspots, actually kind of like OpenCourseWare did, sending servers through the world with all their content on it. So I think that's still valid. It's just the hardware is much cheaper now, so you could send these hotspots for, you know, $10, $15. The other one is, and that's not a technical solution, and so it's hard and complicated, but it's maybe even more important, is regulatory reform, talking to the people in charge of the refugee camps, building alliances of people who are helping them understand why giving access to educational content doesn't undermine or isn't a security risk. It's all the human worries and concerns around the technology that I think need to be addressed. And then the role of the intermediary, I think, is a good question. And I would hope that there will be many, many intermediaries. I mean, your project is a great example, and you're speaking about it tomorrow, I think. Then, you know, there are a number of other organizations who are doing work that's a little bit similar or related. So I would hope that many organizations in many local contexts understand how they could use online materials and this face-to-face support for the students, and then linking that to the accreditation in their particular country, kind of building these alliances. So one of the things we're working with the Open Society Foundations on, essentially nurturing this community, both through financial support, but also by bringing them together and helping them share kind of what are the challenges that they're encountering in different countries, how are they overcoming them, and even just connecting them better. And it's been amazing to me to see how many organizations are interested, but how many are trying to do the same things without being aware of each other. And then also, and this is always the case, there are some people who've been doing something related for a really long time, like the Jesuit Commons, for example, for 7 years, but they were never thinking about themselves as a kind of a player in the Syrian refugee crisis. And so connecting them to people who are addressing that challenge. I need to talk to you about these events, but I hope that you will, or someone from Chiron will join.
Thank you. Perhaps you'll take, did you want to?
I didn't mention specifically the project that we run on, but one of those is this BetterMark adaptive platform, which is a really fascinating project because the idea is to provide these tools that kids can use within the class outside. And it's hard to explain in such a short time, but millions and millions of exercises of this platform that become really a social experience where kids are fascinating completing exercise. I didn't believe it till I saw it. Now, the interesting thing, in order to translate that good practice into something to the policymakers may understand, I think we need better data. Mm-hmm. We have to do a privacy analysis in order to run better learning analytics, because if we, for instance, if we can trace the IP, we can really prove that those kids are learning in their houses, which is a really different scenario of the traditional way of using technology. So we can discuss about later, if you want to.
Any quick questions?
Hi. The theme of the panel is Beyond Boundaries, Global View. I'm from Boston, and in Boston, we have a lot of the same problems that you see in these far-flung places where children don't have access to education. We have $1 billion school budget in Boston, but still kids are not learning. Do you see a means for applying a lot of the work that you've done around the world to places like Boston, other cities in the U.S., other places in wealthy countries where there's these disparities?
I can certainly speak to that. we do. In fact, you heard in the first presentation, you heard Arthur talk about the work that we're engaging in over here. And I wanted to make a reference to, thank you for the question, because the problems are also boundaryless, and that's the point I'm making. One of the things, you know, there was a reference, Archana just made a reference to the project that we're doing in India, the Connected Learning Initiative. And part of the premise there is that good solutions can emanate anywhere, and we have to create the conditions for them to be adopted elsewhere. So there's bidirectionality to this. And one of the things that we're hoping, for instance, that particular project really works with schools in underserved areas, and we are working, trying to bring active learning practices into science, math, engineering, and English education, and doing it using technology platforms they're creating over here, leveraging the edX platform. And the intent is almost like a trickle-up model. How can we learn from those to address, in order to provide solutions over here? And the initiative that MIT has launched and around this integrated teaching learning initiative is actually to see how we can share the learnings from these various initiatives, be located over here or elsewhere, to provide solutions for each other. So the answer is yes. I think the problems that we face are boundaryless, and the solutions can be. And the typical directionality of solutions, you know, and which we variously call north, south, you know, and I think all that is quite challenged in this open and networked world, you know, which is what we are trying to demonstrate.
So I think a lot of the most interesting projects are not in the US or not in developed countries. And it would be very useful for the developed countries to pay more attention to what's going on around the world. So I think partly it's innovation thrives at the fringes. And if you are in a space that has maybe less regulation or less oversight, I am a huge fan of regulation, just to be clear. But there are some pockets of things bubbling up that are really amazing. I might be wrong, but there is an organization in South Africa called Ikamva Youth, and you're familiar with them, right? Yes. And so I think that's a perfect example. They do amazing work with schools in South Africa, have incredible completion and success rates, and I think that model could easily be adopted in Boston.
Thank you.
So one more question from Siberia. I think it's my question is also kind of cross boundary, because we all deal with that. So the question is, you guys all gave some wonderful success stories on your cases, and the question is, how do you deal with, you know, every change, for example, in our country, every significant change means the change in educational standards. And it needs some paperwork, it needs some administrative work, and, you know, it sometimes can get complicated. So whoever of you would like to answer that, so how do you deal with, you know, with change of educational standards and administrative problems, I would say?
In my case?
Are there any?
Yeah, well, I talk about media, digital literacy. Mm-hmm. In my case, it was easy because I belong to the Ministry of Education, so it was a public policy. There are two ways all over the world. Digital literacy is, or there are two options, or is a special media and digital literacy, a special content like mathematics in school, in high school, so it's separate content from the other world, or it's a cross-curriculum content. So it depends on the country, the English country, in Britain, in Australia, it's a separate content. In France, Spain, Argentina, it's cross-culture. It's all over the cross-curriculum. But it's true that all the changes, I see someone talk in the morning also said the same idea. In order to achieve large scale, you need a public policies, and you need the decision makers to be involved.
Right. And increasingly there are. I mean, Europe actually, initially with its Bologna process, you know, started looking at some of that interoperability. And people have, I mean, there are increasingly initiatives that look at the interoperability of these standards. And that's the real last mile problem across institutions, across countries. Thank you for that. One last question, and
Thank you for your presentation. My name is Anna Santos. I'm from Udacity, and I have a question about the employment, connecting learning with employment opportunities, because Stephen and Philip mentioned your accreditation project and your important way to connect people with jobs. I was wondering, like, if you have noticed that this is a good way to actually enforce and motivate people to go through online courses, so they have like a go at the end. That's like Udacity is trying to do this, like getting people to get jobs after they complete the online courses.
Okay, I guess the question would be, can you use, like, say, the online experience as a way to motivate people, the prospect of getting a job for that? I certainly say it, especially if someone feels that there's kind of a gap and something that they don't know. Being able to offer that to them, again, is a very important motivator in many cases. The kinds of situations that we have faced more often, though, is not so much those kind of gaps in hard knowledge or necessary hard technical skills. It's not the engineering student here or something can't get to work because it's a little bit deficient on that. It's the one that it's the person that would come out of school, middle of high school, or at the end of high school, or even has gone for 4 years to a university, got a degree in economics, and comes out and looks around. All the civil service jobs are full. Where do you go? Has no orientation whatsoever to what businesses do or what, you know, what the real work of the economy is. So you could have in that whole range from people leaving in maybe junior high school to even graduates of universities come out with that sudden crushing moment that I don't know where to go here, and I hadn't even thought about having how you would do an interview with someone, how you would prepare maybe a CV and those sorts of things. So that's so in a lot of cases, that can be a big help. Can it totally substitute for the kinds of things that educational aspects that can be addressed, you know, with greater and greater sophistication and availability and all of that now? No, it can't do it. But I think you have to look at both of them.
Thank you, Steve. Very quick comment, and then I'll sum up for this. One of the things I think, Roxana made reference to it, Christopher made reference to it, is not just domain competencies, but this ability to have empowered learners, you know, changes in career or being more proactive about particular career paths, you know, and the opportunities that this blended world is offering in order to come and re-enter your educational spectrum. In fact, almost going away, we hear terms like lifelong learning and flexible learning, so that you do have these opportunities over a lifetime with the a priori assumption that careers are going to change, careers are going to be defined, professions are going to be defined, and you might not always be a job taker, but a job creator, which is a lot of what's going on. I wanted to thank the panelists. One of the things that I picked up was that boundarylessness is a necessary but not sufficient condition for the kinds of changes that we're looking about for quality access. And, you know, I'm glad that through your examples you really identified the various systemic considerations, you know, especially when it comes to, and I was listening to it, I said, what's the term over here? Actionable access. So that, and actionable access recognizes that scale is not a scalar but a vector. There are people coming with diverse preparations in the context of jobs with different motivations and aspirations. And to create the infrastructure, the policy considerations, the cultural considerations, and to show compelling value through data becomes important when you start thinking about really realizing the potential of boundarylessness. So I really wanted to thank the panelists. Please join me in giving them a big hand.